This is where the book depository building is. This is the window where Lee Harvey Oswald was not present. And this is the overpass with the railroad tracks. And then the streets came out here. The president's limousine came here and was here when the first shot was fired. And here when the second, third, fourth, fifth, in this area when the shots were fired. Over here was a wooden fence. With trees. And over here were the key witnesses. And they all said they heard the shots, and they all said they looked in this direction because that's where they heard the shots come from, and they all said they saw puffs of smoke coming behind the wooden fence. When the president was hit, his head was driven directly backward, and to his left had a motorcycle cop over here was struck by brain material from the president and almost knocked off his motorbike. That's what he testified to. Therefore, obviously, the shots came from here. So the first question is, how did Oswald, who was supposed to be here, who wasn't, but who was supposed to be here, how did he shoot the president from the back, from the front? And how did he shoot from three different positions at the same time? Well, he didn't, and that's one way. You kids all remember November 22nd, 1963? What do you mean you weren't alive at that time? All Americans were. In any event, those of you who come later will be able to see that Oswald could not have been the lone assassin, and in fact was not involved at all. And it was done by the Central Intelligence Agency, and they left their initials all over Dealey Plaza for us to find. Think about that.
Is this the exact spot you were standing on November 22nd, Mr. Holland?
What did you see? And what did you hear?
Is this where you were sitting on November 22nd, Mr. Price?
Yes, sir.
Right here?
Right here on this spot.
When that horror hits, wow!
Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere.
He suppressed information where he suborned perjury.
Who was Oswald?
Did he tell you where he thought the shots came from?
Mark Lane, in his over eight decades, has been a civil rights attorney, activist, and author. But most of all, an American. His life is a timeline of civil rights events. I decided to follow him around for a few years and hear his story.
Hey, Squashy.
Yes, if you can keep Squashy.
Hey, Squashy. Come over here. Look here, keep the cuff here.
You gonna vote for a Democrat?
I can't.
Went to James Madison High School. There were thousands of students there. And you can't believe this. This was in New York City. And I never heard of anybody ever being arrested, anybody ever assaulting anybody in a whole school. I think we had 4,000 students.
Education is the true foundation of civil liberty, James Madison.
Maybe this is where it all started for you, reading that every day.
I don't think I read it before today. I actually did pretty well except in one class, which was Latin. I did really badly in Latin. And everybody said, don't worry about it. As long as you're not going to be a lawyer, it won't make any difference.
We lived in Brooklyn. We had
little house, and there was no air conditioning, of course, so in the summertime we kept the windows open with the screens on. Didn't lock the door. Car is out in the driveway in front of the house, never locked. If it was hot and it wasn't going to rain, windows were open all the time. It was really a different world from the one we live in now. My parents never used a derogatory term about any person based upon color, religion, race, ever. And it was just a thing when we were little kids, we knew that it didn't even come up. When I first heard some of these words, I was astonished. My father was an accountant, never made much money. And he told us maybe a year or two before he died, he was almost 90. He said, I want to tell you about how we got Al Capone. I said, I know that accountant's got Al Capone. He said, no, I want to tell you how we got him. I said, we? He said, yes, your mother never knew this. She had died already. He said, two agents of the government came to see me. That's before you were born. And said, we'd like you to look at some books and records. And they had another accountant from someplace else come in. He never met that person, but he heard about it. And they flew him to Chicago, and he went over the books of Al Capone. And his original work was the basis for the analysis which sent Al Capone to prison.
Yeah. You've been talking about Nathan's hot dog for like an hour, Mark.
Yeah, well, my brother is a genius, mathematical genius, and he always wanted fresh French fries. And so they would, when they finished with one basket, they would put a new basket in. And he would see how long the line was and decide where in the line we should be in terms of when a new basket of French fries would come out, right out of the fryer. He was pretty good at it, actually. I got some of these also.
Yeah, okay.
My brother was the most wonderful person I ever met. And for the first 16 years of my life, I was the closest person in the world to him, and he was to me. His name was Lawrence. His friends called him Larry. We called him Laurie. We're born on the same day, my brother and I, February 24th, 2 years apart. He was my role model because although he was very political, he would never say, Bush is a war criminal, which I say, but he wouldn't say that. He would just disagree with the president's policies. And I tried to be like my brother, but he was a teacher, and I became a trial lawyer, and it's very difficult to go through life as a trial lawyer with that as your role model, so I slipped quite a bit.
My name is Ann Lane, and I am Mark's sister.
Have you eaten? You want some? I have to give you some cheese and crackers.
I don't eat. I never know when we're going to eat.
Well, we're not going to eat till after the 7 o'clock event.
Who knows if even after then we'll be allowed
to
eat.
Well, that's why you can have cheese and crackers.
She decides when we eat.
But I decide when I can give you cheese and crackers.
No, I don't think so.
Yeah.
The crackers, would get crumbles on the microphone, no.
We had such fun. They were such wonderful older brothers. They thought I was cute. They thought I was like a little pet. And they never... They played with me, and they sometimes made fun of me, and they sometimes did things that made me cry, but that's in the nature of children. But mostly, they thought I was to be taken care of.
My cousin Everett brought over a German Shepherd. He was only about 5 months old, but my brother and I were terrified, so we did the only manly thing possible. We put our sister in front of us, and we hid. We were very happy to live where we were living in America. But deep down, we knew that if there was a problem, we would respond. And when World War II started, we all did. Almost nobody objected to participating. 18-year-old kids joined the military. There were 11 million of us who did that because we really loved our country. We didn't question the government at all. We were really... So this was like the best of times. It was kind of the worst of times, too. We didn't question the government. We thought that they would not do anything, which wasn't right and fair. We discovered soon that was not true. Anyway, I went to law school and college with the GI Bill of Rights. So when I got out of out of law school, I went to East Harlem, and I opened a storefront office, and I stayed there for 10 years.
So maybe we should stay.
Well, I don't have to come right back. I can wait another day or two.
So we could go up and see.
We should actually spend some time in New York, because I would like to show you East Harlem, where my offices were.
That's what we want to see.
The building I was in, 1677, is just like this one here, and it had a place that roasted coffee underneath it, so the whole place where I smelled the coffee. And we had that whole second floor went all the way back, same depth as this one. And then above it was a house of prostitution, and we all shared the same staircase. It was embarrassing one day when a judge arrived as a customer.
It was maybe among the most, probably the most exciting 10 years of my life. I never made any money. I mean, nobody had any money to pay me for anything. But I stayed there for 10 years and got to know people in the community and to represent mostly kids and things that resulted from their living conditions, lack of education. I mean, I represented so many families where the kids sleeping in the bed had been bitten by rats, and where parents would take turns sitting up at night near the crib to make sure the rats didn't get to the kids, right in the middle of Manhattan. And there were a lot of problems then, there were a lot of problems now. And we formed a group called the East Harlem Reform Democrats.
I say to you that such an attitude is unworthy of free men.
I was running for New York State Legislature, and Eleanor Roosevelt came into the district to endorse me, and she made this record so that we could play it on our sound truck as we went through the district. Now, for anyone under the age of whatever, they don't even know what I'm talking about 78 record. What is 78? That's the revolutions per minute that this record goes around.
To Carlos Rios, who is candidate for the state committeeman in the 10th Assembly District, and to Mark Lane, candidate for Assembly, in the 10th Assembly District.
We formed this group and made up primarily of blacks and Puerto Ricans and some whites. And we built this group and we won. I got elected to the state legislature. We defeated these guys in these contests. And I ran as an insurgent in the Democratic Party. All the power of the Democratic Party was used against me. But we had a citywide concentration in my district. The kids came from Sarah Lawrence, from everywhere to come into the district in this campaign, and we won.
I never really eaten oysters. I would try. I'll try anything.
It's my favorite food in the whole world.
And you just take it like so, and you put it in your mouth, and you eat it.
Which one of the grapes?
It's cold.
I know it's cold. It's raw.
That's a shell. Don't eat the shell. It's got a lot of calcium, but you should eat it anyway.
Been in jail. Were you ever put in jail? Hmm? Did they put you all the way in jail?
Me?
Mm-hmm.
About 25, 30 times.
By the end of the 1950s, racial unrest in America was at a breaking point. In 1961, groups of civil rights activists, both black and white, boarded various forms of public transportation in protest of racial segregation and injustice. Mark Lane, an elected official, was one of them.
The Freedom Riders were a group of people who went to Jackson, Mississippi. At least that was their destination. Very few ever reached there. There were black and white people traveling together throughout the country. Jim Peck had done that. He was a white guy, the heir to Peck and Peck clothing fortune. But he was really a wonderful guy, and he went there with some black folks on a bus planning to go to Jackson, Mississippi. They grabbed them off the bus, beat them, almost killed them. And there, from that came a movement.
This is Robert Chackney in Birmingham, at the home of a Negro clergyman. And with me are part of a group calling themselves the Freedom Riders, an interracial group traveling through the Deep South to challenge some of the segregated bus facilities in this part of the country. Mr. Peck, you obviously have been injured. You're wearing bandages. What happened to you?
I got beaten twice yesterday by hoodlums, once aboard the bus and once in the terminal in Birmingham.
I was a very dear friend of Gene Callender, who was a minister of a very large church in Harlem. And one day, Gene said, I'd like you to come to the church on a Sunday. I said, okay. Why? He said, I'll tell you when you get there. I said, okay. And I came and I saw Percy Sutton. Percy was the head of the NAACP in New York,
And we're in the audience. Gene Cavalier said, I have an announcement to make. Two members of this church, two dear friends, Percy Sutton and Mark Lane, have agreed to be freedom riders. He had not talked to me or Percy about this. He just made that announcement. And I said, did you know about this? He said, no. Gene Callender picked Percy Sutton and me to represent his church and the American people on this trip. And I was a member of the New York State Legislature.
Mark was demonstrating freedom rides before I'd ever even heard about them.
We went from one city to another, mostly by bus, but not always by bus, never getting served any place we went. And he said, I know a place to stay. And we went in there, and it was the Atlanta Black YMCA. There was an elderly black gentleman behind the desk and a few black people in the lobby, and they looked at us and couldn't believe a white guy and a black guy coming here together. He said, you know what this is? I said, yeah, it's a YMCA. I want a room, he wants a room. So we each registered. Percy, you have to understand, is very, very good-looking man, very well-dressed, and very elegant in his speech and careful. And he bent down and grabbed my suitcase and said, I'll hold your bag for you, Mr. Mark. And everybody's looking at him like, you know, and me, a guy like brought my slave with me or something. It was a very, very embarrassing moment, very funny. Finally, we flew into Jackson, Mississippi, and there was a large waiting room there. And Percy and I got off the plane, walked in there. There was one elderly woman who was knitting. Nobody else in the whole place had held hundreds of people. Nobody else was there. Chief of police and a few other deputies in very fancy uniforms were there. And Percy said, I got to go to the men's room. I said, well, this is a problem. I got to go with you. Let's not get arrested in the men's room, okay? Who knows what they're going to say. So I went in with him. We came out and we sat down. And the chief of police came up to me and said, Mr. Lane, I'd like you and your friend to leave here at once. And I said, why is that? He said, because you could start a riot. I said, you got a lot of cops here, right? And there's one little woman over there. If she starts anything, I think you guys can handle it, right? And he said, if you don't leave, you'll be under arrest. And so he arrested us. We were separated then. Separate cells. I mean, far from each other, I guess. I didn't know where he went or where I went. I didn't know where I went, but it was the bars in front of me. We were there for, I think, a day. It's not like going to jail for 15 years and or anything like that. But every time that door closes and you can't go anywhere, you're feeling hopeless. I was the only public official ever arrested as a freedom rider.
You want to go into Dirty Nellie's? Have a beer in Dirty Nellie's?
Should we take a little shoot in there?
Yeah, sure. I think I'll just do it. We'll tell him Bobby said it's okay.
We went to a bar the other day and asked a whole bunch of college kids who killed Kennedy. So. And the question was the same, and all the answers were different there, too.
On November 22nd, 1963, John Fitzgerald Kennedy, the 35th president of the United States, was assassinated in Dallas, Texas.
I am talking about genuine peace, the kind of peace that makes life on earth worth living, the kind that enables men and nations to grow and to hope and build a better life for their children. Not merely peace for Americans, but peace for all men and women. Not merely peace in our time, but peace in all time.
Mark loved Jack Kennedy. I think he's talked about that. And he was Kennedy's campaign manager in New York. At that point, I was living in New York, and I had more reservations about him than Mark did. I didn't like his behavior toward women, which for me is a consideration. And I was concerned that it would spill over to his attitude on issues involving women and gender, which it essentially didn't. But Mark adored him. We were driving up to Peekskill, New York, where my husband and I owned a little house in the country, about an hour from Manhattan. I was pregnant with Leslie, with my older daughter, and we were going up to this house in the country so the two guys would paint the bedroom.
I was with my husband, and Mark was with Susan Brownmiller, with whom he was then involved. And she and I were friends. So the four of us drove up there, and on the way, we heard that Kennedy was assassinated. I can't remember who was driving. It might have been Susan. But I remember Mark was, we were all shaken, but Mark was shattered. His hero was killed. And he said, I shouldn't be driving to paint a baby's room. I should get out now and fly to Dallas and get involved. And we said, come on, Mark. You know, you don't have to do everything. And he really felt bad that he was just going off to do what now became a kind of frivolous activity. And then they talked about Oswald had been arrested. And Mark said, I should get to the airport because they're going to kill that guy. And we said, yeah. So we drove to Peekskill. And Susan and I curled up on the couch to watch TV. And the two guys were in the bedroom painting when Oswald got killed. And we shrieked and said, my God, they've killed Oswald. They've shot Oswald. Mark walked out with a brush in his hand and he said, I'm responsible because I knew it was going to happen and I didn't do anything about it. And now I have to do something about it.
In 1959, John Harrington, a political activist in Yorkville, and I met, and we really liked John Kennedy, and we were working for him. Among the liberals in New York City, we were like the only two probably who liked John Kennedy over the less Catholic candidates who were running. That wasn't a problem for us, it was for some folks. But we supported John Kennedy. And when he got the nomination, he was grateful. I met with Bobby Kennedy and spent time working in the campaign. I was a candidate for the New York State legislature on the same ticket. The first name was John Kennedy. The last name on the ballot was Mark Lane. And eventually, I became one of the campaign managers in New York City for John Kennedy. And it was a really exciting time in America. It's not that a lot was accomplished during the years he was president, but there was a feeling that something was going to happen. After 8 years of Eisenhower in the White House and things were going so slowly, now the young couple was there, good-looking young couple, a young child, the lights were burning at night at the White House. It was great excitement and enthusiasm that something could be done. Then he was dead, and no one was prepared for anything like that happening. The FBI said at once, remember, it was not the Warren Commission report. The first report was the FBI. It only took them a few minutes, and they said Lee Harvey Oswald was the assassin of President Kennedy, and he acted alone. That was the position before there was an investigation. You can't rule out a conspiracy when you're talking about the death of the president, because even if Oswald had fired all of the shots, who's to say nobody paid him? Nobody suggested it to him. That's what a conspiracy is, two or more people acting in concert to achieve an illegal end. You have to investigate before you can say it. So when Hoover said, the director of the FBI, J. Edgar Hoover, said Oswald acted alone, there was no conspiracy, and all of the news media supported that, there was no conspiracy, they were telling us a lot more about them and what they wanted and what their plan was than they were about what actually happened that day.
In your investigation so far, what do you feel is the strongest evidence that Lee Oswald did not kill the president?
Well, the shots were fired from an area different from the area that Oswald was present at, allegedly. Oswald was supposed to be in the Book Depository building on the sixth floor. That building was to the rear of the presidential limousine. The eyewitnesses state that the shots were fired from the grassy knoll or overpass directly in front of the limousine. The medical testimony corroborates this, indicating that the first bullet entered the president's throat from the front. Oswald was at that time 75 yards behind the president.
No matter what the American Medical Association says, the American people have now seen the Zapruder film many, many times on various news broadcasts and John and JFK by Oliver Stone. When the bullet hit the president in the head, the president was driven suddenly and violently backwards, smashed into the seat and bounced off of it. That could not have come from a bullet fired from the back.
Are you satisfied with the cooperation you have received thus far from the Warren Commission?
No.
The most important part of the cover-up of the assassination was the murder of Lee Harvey Oswald. If he had been tried, based upon the evidence that they had, he would have been found not guilty, even in Dallas, Texas, because there was no evidence. And then the country would say, well, then who killed him? So if you wanted to cover up the case, you had to kill Oswald, and they did it in the basement of the Dallas Police and Courts building. And if you were thinking and alive at the time, you had to say, there's some questions here, and I did.
More than a year has passed since the death of our president, but not one national radio or television network has presented a single program, not one network program in America, which in any respect challenged the conclusions of the government.
There are very many people in this country in positions of power who are afraid of what they might see and therefore will not look at the evidence and will look at anything else and participate in all kinds of other charges. The Warren Commission report is a fraudulent document from the first page to the last page. Any member of the press who wants to look at the 26 volumes of evidence and compare it to the commission's conclusions could very easily see that.
Do you believe Oswald received orders from someone in the CIA to assassinate the president?
I don't think Oswald assassinated the president.
Speed. He took the book to every publisher in the United States, every major publisher in New York. I think there were 16, and they blew their minds. And they would wanted to, they want a contract, and they would give him a contract. And then some of them even wrote a check and gave him an advance because they were so excited. They wanted to hold it. They didn't want any competition. And without fail, 1 or 2 days later, each and every one of those publishers would come to call Mark on the phone and say, "I'm sorry, but we can't publish your book."
When you have a recipe for artichokes, they say use the heart. The bottom, actually. And then you just throw this stuff out, but I love it. So I sit here and stand here and go like this.
And they didn't give a reason why. They just said, "I'm sorry, but we've decided we can't publish the book." And in the case of one of the publishing houses that had given him an advance, they even said, "You can keep the advance," which was absurd, but they wanted nothing to do with it.
Then I went to see Arthur Cohn, who was the editor-in-chief of Holt Reinhardt at Winston in his office in New York. And he said, "Okay, I can't guarantee that we'll publish it because I don't run the company, I'm the editor-in-chief. But I can guarantee you this, if it's not published, I will resign as editor-in-chief and every editor will resign." I said, "Okay," so then I was elated. We shook hands, we had dinner. He was a wonderful guy, and then he called me later. He said, "The FBI has come to see the president of the company and said that John, that's Jed Hoover, the Bureau, and me do not want Lane's book published." And made some reference to tax problems that all the officials could have with the publisher, etc. And so the president went to see Arthur Cohn, his editor-in-chief, and said, "What should we do?" And Arthur said, "It's a simple choice. We have an option here. We can either not publish it or double the advertising budget and publish it."
Mark wrote it over a period of years because he had to, in order to write this book, he had to study all of the 26 volumes of the Warren Commission.
These are the 26 volumes of the Warren Commission. Here's the one volume of fraudulent analysis called the Warren Commission Report. And to start it off, here are the complete fairy tales of Brothers Grimm.
Mark was not obsessed. He was very pragmatic. You read the 26 volumes, you lay out all the evidence, you write a book, you annotate it so that everybody reading that book knows there's a document that backs up everything he said. There was even a class at UCLA, the former lawyer for the commission, Wesley J. Liebler, used his students to check every annotation in Rush to Judgment to find out if there was a flaw, something that, a weakness, Achilles' heel, where they could get Mark. And there were none. They got all the way through and it was flawless.
And so I'm minding my own business and then Mark Lane comes into my life, not physically, just listening to and hearing the buzz. Who is this guy? See, I knew of him before I knew him. Who is this guy? And how long will he be alive?
So these are FBI reports about the Kennedy assassination and me. The Warren Commission asked the FBI
to send FBI agents and use suitable pretext when necessary to listen to and record every single speech I gave, which were given sometimes two or three times a day all throughout the United States. I was doing a program in St. Louis, late night radio show, and somebody called and said he had to talk to me, but not on the air. And he said, I have to see you. This is very, very important. So like an idiot, I went to where he said, to some deserted area by cab, and then asked the cab to wait, and there he was. And he said, I work for the CIA, and I've been asked to kill you in Chicago on this date. You're going to be at this hotel. In fact, you're going to be in this room. You knew the room, he said. I said, how do you know I'm going to be in that room? He said, they put everybody there. It's like a sound studio. It's all bugged. And they get to hear everything you say. In the afternoon, you're going to cross the street to go to a radio station there. And when you do, I'm supposed to hit you with a pickup truck and kill you. I said, and you're telling me this because? He said, I'm not going to do it. And I said, why? And he said, I have killed people for the CIA, but I have a code of ethics. I will not kill an American in America. I said, I don't quite grasp this code of ethics, but I totally support it in this case.
And now I look back and realize there's certain things that the FBI and the CIA can't kill.
If we can change presidents by shooting them, and therefore change policies, then we're not a democracy, we're not a republic. If you can kill the president of the United States and have the government lie about it, then where are we? And this was so clear to me that I didn't understand why it wasn't clear to everyone, but it was clear. It was clear to the media, it was clear to liberals, all of whom were so frightened by what this meant that instead of investigating, they spent most of the time attacking me for asking questions.
I really ought to point out to you,
yes,
that this material occurred in the first half of the program.
When I was not permitted to respond, yes.
You had the opportunity,
sir,
of meeting the points that were made in the criticism of your film in the first part of the program.
Well, you know that's not quite accurate. I was not at all permitted to even comment upon
We have a commission appointed that you at the time said was false. Now, Mark, as events turn out, it may turn out that the position you took at the time was the correct position. It may well turn out that way.
Well, it has.
But in the meantime, the trauma that we have gone through over and over and over again, I think, has been amplified.
When our president is killed, we have the right to know who killed him, and at this very moment...
Why? Why do we have that right? And why must we go through this trauma?
Are you charging the Chief Justice with a cover-up?
Yes, I'm, of course, charging the government with not only suppressing information, I'm charging the FBI and the Secret Service with operating this case from a theory that Oswald was the assassin, that he acted alone, and I'm charging them with pursuing investigation only along those lines.
Mark wasn't just on the enemies list of Richard Nixon. Mark was somebody who both J. Edgar Hoover and the FBI and the CIA, they wanted him dead. And he was creating controversies that they couldn't handle.
If he had lived, of course, he would be entitled to counsel. I think he is entitled to counsel now, and I think all of America now is entitled to have counsel for Lee Oswald so that we can find out, actually, what took place on November 22nd.
From the time that the president was killed, it was more than a year before anyone was permitted to raise a question on a network radio or television program in America. Even say, you know, maybe it wasn't a good idea to have the Warren Commission act in secrecy. Think about today. Wouldn't all the media say, well, what's the evidence? What's going on? There, they said, everything will be done top secret and we'll issue a report when we issue the report. And the media said, wonderful. Not one editorial in a single American newspaper saying, why can't this testimony be open? If Oswald was alive, there'd be an open and public trial. He's dead. Isn't he entitled to have counsel represent him? Or aren't we entitled to a public trial? Not one editorial in one newspaper in America, not even the left ones. Nobody said a word.
The idea was, how do you get the truth out? I mean, Mark has laid it out in Rush to Judgment, and it's flawless. The people had not accepted the truth. The lie was still out there.
The FBI and the Secret Service have told witnesses not to discuss this case with anyone. Two witnesses have told me that, and a reporter in Dallas indicates to me that dozens of witnesses have told him that they've been ordered by the FBI not to discuss this case.
We are at the office of Penn Jones, Jr. in Midlothian, Texas, 25 miles from the Dallas courthouse. For the past 2 years, he alone in the Dallas area has conducted an independent investigation into the assassination of President Kennedy.
I really believe that the only way you can believe the Warren Report is to not read it.
Have you found it difficult to uncover the facts this time?
Yes, it's very difficult. Witnesses are reluctant. Some of them have gone into hiding, or at least cannot be found by me.
Mr. Holland was a former deputy sheriff. He had been the supervisor at that time of the Union Terminal Railroad. They were railroad tracks up there. And he was asked to be up there in a quasi-official capacity, make sure nobody throws anything down on the president's car.
And did you see the effect of the next bullet which struck President Kennedy?
I saw the effects of the next bullet that struck the president.
I said to Mr. Holland, has anyone asked you not to talk to me? He said, yes. The FBI and the Secret Service have said, don't tell anybody what you saw. Never say a word. I said, and yet, Mr. Holland, here you are being filmed. And he thought for a minute and he said, when you can see that, your president, his head blown apart, and you can't talk to the American people, tell them the truth about what you saw, it's time to give this country back to the Indians if they'll take it.
I say five of the people in this book I knew personally, the two Kennedy boys, Malcolm, Medgar Evers, Martin. That's the atmosphere that Mark had to confront the 20th century.
When the government of the United States, and it will not do it without us insisting and marching and fighting and voting and putting this matter on the agenda, but when the day comes that the government of the United States tells us the truth and all of the factual details about the assassination, including their role in the murder, when that day comes, for the first moment, honor will be restored to this nation. Thank you.
When I lectured about the Kennedy assassination, I always used to say, you all remember where you were November 22nd, 1963. And everybody did. It was something that made us Americans of a certain age and a certain time. We remember that. If we forgot where we were on our 21st birthday, our first wedding anniversary, fifth wedding anniversary, we remember where we were November 22nd, 1963. When we heard President Kennedy was killed. And every time I lectured, often to thousands of people, people would come up and say, I want to tell you where I was that day. And everybody remembered it. And then I was lecturing one day to a college audience, and I said, we all remember where we were on November 22nd, 1963. And I looked around and I said, none of you were born at that point. I think I've given this talk for too long already. It had become history, and it is history now. And the people I talk to now weren't alive. They have heard of Kennedy. Most of them never even heard of Oswald. And most of them don't know about the Warren Commission, but the facts are there, and we'll keep on talking about it.
They're open.
Okay.
You wanna go in first?
It's homemade gourmet ice cream.
No.
And this is just chocolate?
That is chocolate,
chocolate
chips and cherries.
I'm going to have a sugar cone with that and a butter pecan.
Okay.
You're not a real American, you know?
I'm not a real American?
No, you're not a real American.
Because I don't like ice cream?
Yeah. You could be expelled from the country.
The United States military was involved in the conflict in Vietnam from the 1950s until the 1970s. This involvement also caused nationwide domestic conflict with Americans and their opinions about the war.
This is a book I wrote called Conversations with Americans.
That was a very controversial book. Right?
What did I write that wasn't
right? Right, I guess so. What
I don't do children's stories, you know. What?
Right.
Okay, what?
Was that the most controversial one? That one?
It's hard to say which is the most controversial. I couldn't get most of my books I couldn't get published without long, hard struggles. Most people know me as someone who worked on the Kennedy assassination. I did some other things, and this is one of the other things, and I fought against the war in Vietnam. I did 32 interviews, each with Americans who were Vietnam veteran survivors. Each one either witnessed terrible atrocities, or in almost every case, participated in atrocities and wanted to tell the truth to the American people.
It was obvious to Mark that you have to get the people who were on the ground, with boots on the ground, you got to get them to express their opposition to the war.
And so I started interviewing them and taking notes. And so it came out, Conversations with Americans. And as soon as it did, I went on a tour. And the book was doing fairly well. The New York Times ran a front page review by Neil Sheehan, in which he said the book was a hoax. Everything was a lie. He had inside sources. These guys didn't even exist. If one did exist, he had never been to Vietnam. Story after story. And at that point, Simon & Schuster, they withdrew the book, the hardcover. They canceled the contract of the paperback, and they demanded a return of the advance, which they had paid me. It became clear to me that you could not reach the American people through a publisher or the New York Times. There had to be some other way to reach the American people. And I said, why don't we have a meeting where all the GIs can tell the stories to the American people? I said, I know a guy who does public relations really well, Steve Jaffe.
The Winter Soldier investigation brought together anti-war soldiers. It wasn't a court. There was no trial. They were confessing to their war crimes.
I saw one case where there were two prisoners, and one prisoner was staked out on the ground, and he was cut open while he was alive. And they told the other prisoner, if he didn't tell them what they wanted to know, that they would kill him. And I don't know what he said because he spoke in Vietnamese, but then they killed him after that anyway.
Were these primarily civilians, or do you believe that they were
The way
NBA?
That we distinguished between civilians and VC, VC had weapons and civilians didn't, and anybody that was dead was considered a VC. If you killed someone, they said, how do you know he's a VC? The general reply would be, he's dead, and that was sufficient.
Mark and the organizers of it decided they would hold it in Detroit because Detroit was right across the river from Canada. So the people in Canada who were against the war and who had escaped to Canada could testify by closed circuit. They could testify about the same crimes in the same hearings.
So in the meantime, I'd written a book, and then we had done the Winter Soldier investigation. And we were doing everything we could to bring to the attention of the American people what we had become.
I don't know if the book started it, but Mark helped to start a GI coffeehouse movement, which went all across the United States and the Pacific Rim bases. And everywhere there was a base, there was a coffeehouse nearby where soldiers could go and express their opposition to the war and at least speak freely. And Mark started one in Mountain Home, Idaho, called the Covered Wagon.
First of all, the name. And as you know, in any organization, it's the hardest thing. So they're sitting around and somebody said, Covered Wagon, how about that? And we said, yeah, great, great. A top secret code word is if you suspect the base is about to be infiltrated by the enemy, is you yell, Covered Wagon, Covered Wagon. Huh? The Covered Wagon musicians. We marched 40 miles through the desert from the Air Force Base to the federal building where we had a meeting. This is a song that actually I wrote with Jimmy Schaafer. I wrote the chorus.
Silver, silver, don't fly alone.
On November 18th, 1978, 918 people died in the People's Temple compound in Guyana, known as Jonestown. Mark Lane was there and one of the only survivors of the massacre.
Whenever we talk about strongest poison, he doesn't like to talk about it. And there's a documentary I saw on the History Channel, and I saw a glimpse of him. I was kind of struck by it. He was thin, and he had a kind of a yellow shirt on. And I'd tell him I got this documentary thing. He'd say, "Don't save it. I don't want to see it." It's a hole in his heart, you know.
Just before I went to Guyana, to Jonestown, in Guyana, to meet with the people there and to talk about the King assassination to them. And then I went in later with Congressman Ryan, who was killed there, because he wanted to help get people out who wanted to leave, and I went in with him. Just before that, the people at People's Temple gave me this album, which is called He's Able, People's Temple Choir. And I will say that these are incredibly talented people. This, I think, is in Ukiah, California, when they were there. I think that's where this picture was taken. This record was made. This is Jim Jones. He was looking a lot younger than and different. When I saw him, he was bloated, crazy, and clearly a drug addict. But he kept people captive there, really. Most of the people there were women. Most of them were black. And they had better schools for the kids there than they had in their own communities in the slums of California. They had better health care, and they were escaping from something which was quite horrible, and that is the oppression of the black community in Watts and various other places, and they were escaping to go to some place where they thought it would be better. And Ryan saw all that, and he said, "You know, a lot of these people were from my district." He said, "They voted for me." And he said, "This is a remarkable thing that Jim Jones has done. There's only one thing wrong with it. He's here."
We're not yet certain of exactly what happened at the People's Temple camp in Guyana last Saturday, but as we've just heard, some members of the sect had agreed on mass suicide if they felt or were instructed that their group was threatened by any outside force. And their leader, Jim Jones, had been depressed and talked of suicide. He felt there was a conspiracy against him.
"I'm from the United States government. We're here to inquire into the health and the welfare of American citizens who are here."
After credentials were approved by the Guyanan government representatives, Congressman Leo Ryan and his party met with Mark Lane and Charles Gary, lawyers representing the People's Temple.
We were in that same place where the theater, where the performance took place, and he was interviewing people. Congressman Ryan was, his secretary was there, a couple people were there, and a big white guy came up. I didn't see this guy before, but I thought he must have been with Ryan's party because he walked right up to him and put his arm around him from the back.
Brought a knife very close to the congressman's throat and neck and held it up against the neck and chest and held it up against there. The congressman first thought the man was fooling. He said, "Oh, come on, cut it out," in a very relaxed way. And I wondered who he had ever known who could be that familiar with him in Jonestown.
And I thought, you know, he did it in a kind of a threatening way, but I thought it must be his friend. Boy, what's he doing? This is not a place to be kidding around like that.
Just as they were about to be taken to the airport, a man with a knife tried to kill Congressman Ryan. Ryan told Harris what happened.
"Yeah, he said something about rob and choke and kill and or knife. I don't know. But the what he said was he intended to kill him."
And then the congressman saw the knife and realized it was not a joke. And he struggled, and he said, "Help," and he pushed the man's hand away a little bit.
And he started to stick into Ryan's chest. And I jumped up and I grabbed his wrist. And we struggled for a while, and he fell down. And he ran off, and Ryan was down on the ground. Ryan, we'll never forget this. He had a blue button-down shirt, buttoned except for every button till the neck. And there was blood.
And I said, "Leo, have you been injured? Are you wounded?" And he said, "I don't know."
And he was lying on his back, and I ripped open his shirt, and there was no blood on him. And the blood came from someplace else. And I didn't know where the blood came from, but he was in a state of shock.
I said to Jim Jones, who had been standing there calmly watching this whole thing, "Call the police. There's an attempted murder. Call the police." And he said, "Oh, yes, we will." He never did.
And Jones came over and spoke very coldly to him. He said, Does this change everything? Because until then, Ryan was saying, you know, it'd be an interesting report. I'm not going to say about terrible, terrible things here. And he said, yes, it does. It changes everything. I know this was a really dangerous situation, and I said to the congressman, well, your report will still be fair and unbiased. And he picked it up and said, yes. He said, that's right, Mark. This could take place in any city in America. It does not a reflection upon the whole Jonestown experiment or what's taking place here. I'm going to say many positive things. I said, maybe you ought to leave, Congressman. I think you're the magnet for this activity now. So let's get out of here. And he said, well, I'm talking to people who want to leave, and I'm getting their names, and I'm going to help process them out. And if you would take over that, then I would go now. My idea is that we should all leave, actually. I wasn't suggesting that he leave and I stay. But those were his terms, and so I stayed. With Charles Gary, who was a lawyer for People's Temple, he stayed. He was very reluctant to. I said, Charles, you're that lawyer. If I'm staying, you're staying. So he said he would stay. And they left. We thought we were in more danger than they were, but when they got down to the Port Kaituma Airport, they were killed. Congressman Ryan was killed. NBC guy Don was killed. Other people were wounded.
There was one announcement on the radio that said Mark Lane was at the airport and presumed dead. And that was the one radio announcement my father heard. And he called me up. He was devastated. And I said, we don't know if it's true.
So I called his wife and I said, you know, I just heard the news. Have you heard from Mark? She said, no. So I said, well, I'm going to rent a plane and go over there.
Congressman Ryan had died. Some cameraman had died. I said, you know any names? He said, I don't remember. I said, Don Harris. Don was a friend of mine. He was more than just a reporter. He was a good reporter, but more than just a reporter. He became a soldier for the liberation of the people there. That's why they killed him.
Jones called me into a meeting, and he said, you have thwarted the will of the people.
He said, the people are very angry with you because you've helped bring these people in who are destroying our temple. They're very angry with you, so I'm going to send you down to East House, and you stay there.
And he ordered two guys to take me back to a hut where we were going to stay. One of them was the guy that tried to kill Congressman Ryan. He had a big bandage around his hand. Then I knew where all the blood came from. He had been cut someplace in his hand, and there was a lot of blood. That was not encouraging that he was going to be in charge of me. And then up on the hill, I heard the meeting. Jones called a meeting and was talking about revolutionary suicide and we all have to die.
Talking about the beauty of death, how it was marvelous to die with dignity, and this was part of the struggle against fascism, this death, the deaths of all the people there.
People were screaming no, and I heard this last minutes of Jonestown from where I was. And then two guys came over, two black guys with weapons, automatic weapons, pointed at this little hut and said, Charles, Mark, come out, we're all going to die.
It's a beautiful thing to die for what you believe in. It's a great and beautiful thing. And he was smiling, and he seemed almost euphoric and also calm at the same time.
They were in a mode of some kind. They were waiting for this moment. They were following what Jones told them they had to do. So nothing I said reached them until I said, well, listen, at least you will know that when Charles and I go back, we will tell the truth to the world about what happened here. You no doubt note the presumption that we're going to walk out of there. And one of them, from San Francisco, said, I read the book you wrote with Dick Gregory about Martin King. You told the truth to the world about that. Mark, tell the truth to the world about us too. I said, how do I get out of here?
He saw Jonestown different from what I did. I saw Jonestown as him being hurt. I wasn't going over there. My sole concern when it happened wasn't about Jonestown. It was about my friend. And I'm going over there and find out if he's okay. If he's dead, then I'm gonna hug him and see if I can bring the body back. That's how I felt about it.
A few weeks later, very likely, that entire group would have gone to the Soviet Union and would be living in various cities throughout the Soviet Union. In fact, the first week of December, 50 people from Jonestown were going to Moscow as guests of the Soviet Union.
Obviously, it was going to be a terrible blow to the United States that 1,000 people, many of them women, most of them black, had decided they'd rather live in the Soviet Union. If they can't live in the middle of a jungle, rather live in the Soviet Union, they'd go back to America and to the ghettos. But 1,000 people died. And of course, the press called it, said they all committed suicide, which was an absolute lie.
These were not robots. These were not people who had been mesmerized and brought there.
That all killed themselves, and you're telling
they
were
murdered.
Robots?
They were murdered. They were murdered. They did not kill themselves. The medical examiner of Guyana said that over 700 of the people there were murdered.
Police found, the government has, the tapes of people are screaming, no, no, no. I heard it live. And they have the tapes of people screaming, no, no, no. And their guys with guns telling them, drink it, or we'll shoot you. They drank this, and it was Kool-Aid in the United States. Down there was Flavor-Aid. You know if they're going to shoot you. If they're going to shoot you, it's going to kill you. And if you're going to drink it, maybe it's not poison. So they opted to drink it, and then they died. Little babies. It was just a really horrifying moment. But the United States government has a lot to answer for and hasn't been confronted with the questions and been forced to give answers yet. But one day, maybe they will.
But one time we were here, my whole family, and it was quite crowded, and Martin Luther King was here, and Ralph Abernathy was here. I knew Martin. I'd met him before. We worked together, so I went over and said hello, and I said to my mother, that's Martin Luther King. He has just become famous enough, so if you knew who it was, you recognized him. But if you didn't know who it was, you just didn't recognize him. So as soon as I said it's Martin Luther King, everybody got excited and came over. A lot of black people working behind the counter there. They jumped over the top and shook hands with him.
Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will.
On April 4th, 1968, beloved pastor, activist, and civil rights leader Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated in Memphis, Tennessee, allegedly by James Earl Ray.
Okay, you're on marker?
Yeah. Okay. Tell me when you're ready.
Okay, anytime.
James, it's been said that during 1963 and 1964, while you were in a cell block at the Missouri State Penitentiary in Jefferson City, that you saw Dr. King on television every single day.
Yes.
And according to Mr. McMillan, an author, you boiled, you were galvanized into action, your knuckles turned white, and you said, somebody's got to get him, somebody's got to get him. Is any of that true?
No, that's incorrect.
Here's a book about the assassination of Martin Luther King. It came out under the name, codename Zorro, which is a title that Dick Gregory liked. I always hated it. Anyway, Zorro was a name they assigned to him, the FBI primarily. And then everybody in government used it when talking about him. So that was the name of the book. It came out later under a different title. This is this latest incarnation, Murder in Memphis. And it's with the book I wrote with Dick Gregory.
We collaborated in books together. He didn't disturb me in the part I was writing. I didn't disturb him. But I never would have done the book because I know that anything I said, he could get the information. Great researcher.
A lot of people are asking us, do we think the book will be a bestseller? I don't know that, but I know it's already a bestseller at the FBI building.
Well, here is an interesting picture. Dick Gregory, James R. Ray's brother, Jerry Ray, and me, all working together.
Just let me say that I am pleased and proud to have worked with Mark on probably one of the most important books of our time, and I want to thank the publishers, Printers Hall, and all the researchers and people that believe that the truth would eventually come out.
I was asked by the leadership, the black leadership in America, to represent James Earl Ray. He pleaded guilty and I wasn't involved then, but years later the black leadership came to the conclusion that there was no doubt that Dr. King was not killed by James Earl Ray. And this was all the leadership.
Two men to whom Ray had written letters denying he was the assassin went to visit Ray in prison last week. The Reverend Jesse Jackson, who was on King's SCLC staff and traveling with him in Memphis, and the Reverend James Lawson, who organized the marches in Memphis in 1968. After they had talked to Ray, I asked if they believed he was the killer.
I do not. I have profound doubt that he killed Dr. King. I am convinced that he was not involved alone.
So they asked me if I would participate in trying to get a trial for James Earl Ray. Martin Luther King became the most eloquent leader of the civil rights movement, maybe in its history, in the history of this country. And he had rallied people, white and black, all around this country to the cause.
But I'm a saying tonight that I know that justice is indivisible. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere.
And then he did something which was very dangerous for him. He spoke out against the war in Vietnam.
He was talking about changing the movement. He was talking about changing the movement in two ways. Number one, opposition to the war in Vietnam. He made the speech here in New York City, April 4th, 1967, the next year to the day he was killed.
I want to make it very clear that I'm going to continue with all of my might, with all of my energy, and with all of my action to oppose that abominable, evil, unjust war in Vietnam.
Dr. King's office and supporters, Andy Young, people like that, had booked Dr. King into the Holiday Inn Rivermont. The memorandum written by the FBI at the direction of J. Edgar Hoover went to the news media. It said, why is Dr. King staying at the Holiday Inn Rivermont, famous big hotel owned by white people? He should stay at a place owned by Negroes.
The Lorraine Motel. It was written by J. Edgar Hoover. We have the documents now. Hoover, through blind documents sent to the news media, started the entire campaign to get Dr. King into the Lorraine Motel, not just out of the Holiday Inn Rivermont, but into the specifically into the Lorraine Motel, which was built, you've seen it, like a shooting gallery.
It was a long balcony. Across the street there were buildings, bushes there. One could kill him. They couldn't kill him at the Holiday Inn Rivermont that easily, if once he was in the hotel. And it was the FBI that placed Dr. King there.
Dr. King's security in Memphis was reduced from 12, and now in the heat of the new controversy which was developing, in the heat of the riot and the hard feelings, it was reduced from 12 to 2.
Mark Lane says that his client, James Earl Ray, had no motive, that Ray is not a racist. Reverend Lawson, incidentally, agrees. Lane said that Ray had been forced by law enforcement officials to enter a plea of guilty.
In fact, if you would ask James Earl Ray today, you say you didn't do it, why should I believe you? His answer would be, as it has been on numerous occasions in the past, you shouldn't believe me. We should have a trial.
Sometime after that, I talked to Ralph Abernathy, who was Dr. King's closest friend. There's a famous picture of everybody pointing on the balcony. And I said, Ralph, I want to show you the picture. He said, Mark, I don't want to see it again. I said, do you know everybody in the picture? And he said, yes. I said, I don't think you do. He said, all right, I'll look at the picture. I said, who is that man? He said, I don't know. He was a person who worked for the Memphis Police Department. He knew every place Dr. King was going to go in advance of going there. He's the one that pointed, and that's why everybody pointed. And when people came down later and said to the police who had arrived, shots came from the bushes over there. They paid no attention because this guy, Merrill McCullough, who they knew was one of them, a police officer, said, no, it came from up there. There was no investigation. The next day, the mayor had all the trees and bushes removed, all cut down. So the scene was totally destroyed.
Our investigation leads us to the conclusion that the eyewitness testimony that is available, that the documentary evidence that is available causes and constrains us to reach the
inexorable conclusion that persons in the leadership and officials, other officials of the Federal Bureau of Investigation must be considered to be prime suspects in the murder of Dr. Martin Luther King.
We have witnesses who say that James Earl Ray was not in the boarding house or in the bathroom when the shot was fired.
The witness who could testify that Ray was not the man in the bathroom, said Lawson, was Grace Walton. When King was killed, she lived in the room next to the bathroom from which the shot was fired. It was her common law husband, Charlie Stevens, who told police that he saw Ray run from the bathroom. Grace Walton says Stevens was lying.
Charles Stevens was so drunk he couldn't see his own face, let alone anybody else's.
But you could see the man pretty good?
Yes.
Was the man James Earl Ray?
No.
Sir, they went to see Grace Stevens. Said, Grace, FBI, military intelligence, local police, Grace, we want you to do something for your country. We want you to sign the affidavit so Ray can be brought back to the United States, and otherwise there'll be riots and a lot of problems. We want you to do that. She said, could I see a picture of this Mr. Ray? They showed her the picture. She said, how old is that man? How tall is that man? She said, gentlemen, you got the wrong man. That's not the man who left the bathroom. The man who left the bathroom was smaller, older, and didn't look anything at all like this Mr. Ray. They threatened her. Terrible things will happen to you.
She was destroyed by the state of Tennessee as a witness.
Mark Lane, James Earl Ray's attorney, says the contradictions in Grace Walden's statement are understandable because of the heavy dosages of drugs she was given at a mental hospital. Lane says Grace was put into a mental institution and kept there for 9 years because she refused to identify Ray as the man in the bathroom.
The hospital records show that when she was placed in the institution, they decided that she probably should be kept there until after the trial of James Earl Ray. That's some medical diagnosis.
This woman was a teacher. She was a pianist who taught piano playing. She had never been in a mental institution, never had a problem. She drank too much. She and her husband, Charlie Stevens, drank too much. But they never had any problem in their lives, any with the police, anybody. And I said, my name is Mark Lane, and I'm looking into the assassination of Dr. King. She said, it's no use talking to me, Mr. Lane. I'm just going to tell you, I don't care how long you keep me in this place, I'm never going to say anything which is a lie. I said to Grace, do you want to get out of here? She said, yes, can you help me? And I brought a legal proceeding to get her release. And we raised it, and it was a scandal, and they finally released her to a halfway house.
We got her to a halfway house, and they wouldn't tell me where she was. I found out where she was, and I called her, the halfway house. And I said, Grace, you know, this is, yes, I said, can people hear us? She said, sort of. I said, in other words, nobody's listening on the phone, but in the room with you. She said, exactly right. I said, this is your cousin. She said, oh, cousin, I haven't talked to you in a long time. I said, can I take you out for dinner? And she said, that would be very nice. What time? I said, how about 6 o'clock? And she said, fine. I said, pack some stuff. You're not going back. She said, I understand. I said, don't take too much. She said, I understand. Yes. And she came out, and we had a friend pick her up, and we changed cars twice, went to the airport, and got the airport, and finally drove off. But as we were about to leave in the plane, CBS, local CBS, heard about it and came there with their TV crew. Lights on a plane. It's very bright. And the captain came out and said, what's going on here? And here was Grace. She had no teeth. She had been on drugs for 10 years, which they gave her in the institution. She had an old tattered dress. And we were sitting in first class. And there were the only two seats left. And the pilot said, what's going on here? Looked very suspiciously at us. And I said, this is the heir to the Jack Daniels fortune. She's a little eccentric. And Grace looked up to the pilot and she said, and when we're airborne, all the drinks are on me.
After Mark wrote Codename Zorro with Dick Gregory, James Earl Ray heard about that. Ray, who thought he didn't have a chance in hell of doing anything, wrote to Mark and said, I would like to have you represent me because I really want another chance. I want another trial.
Then the House Select Committee on Assassinations had a hearing and they called James Earl Ray before him, and I was there representing him. And people all around the country was live on TV, people were watching James Earl Ray testify. I thought he was doing a credible job, and then they said, now we're going to read an affidavit into the record. Here's a copy for everybody, and it was from a high official from London who claimed he had interviewed James Earl Ray and that Ray had made a full and complete confession.
James Earl Ray was confronted with the committee's most dramatic evidence so far, an interview committee investigators had 2 weeks ago with a former British police inspector. The inspector, Alexander Anthony East, told the committee he spent days locked in a cell guarding Ray in 1968 after Ray was arrested in England. At Ray's request, Congressman Samuel Devine read what East told the committee about Ray.
He just hated black people. He said so on many occasions. In fact, he said he tried to get into Africa or was going to Africa to try to shoot some more. He was telling me that for him to have shot a black man of note in certain parts of America would make him into a national hero anyway.
Somebody came up to me maybe 5 minutes later and tapped me on the shoulder. It was one of the guys who worked for Congress. And he said, there's a phone call for you, Mr. Lane. A lawyer from, a barrister from London, who was there visiting in Los Angeles, visiting his cousin. He said, let me tell you about East. This man is a major criminal in Great Britain. He was with the police, but he's used that position to do jewel robberies. He's been indicted and charged in many, many cases with making up confessions for people who he didn't even meet.
Ray's lawyer exploded, charging that former police inspector East's interview is unreliable because East lost his police job in an alleged corruption scandal.
It was a height of irresponsibility not to inform the American people about that background. Yes, I did. But if I did not receive a phone call from an English lawyer, the American people would not know of the deceit of this committee. This is perhaps the most outrageous thing this committee has done. It's outrageous.
Before Ray left to return to prison in Tennessee, the committee assured him that the former British police inspector's background is now being checked to determine the reliability of what Ray himself called the most damning statement ever made against him.
This is like the most unreliable person in the world, and they're presenting him as a spokesman. He's been fired from the police department.
His lawyer, Mark Lane, has made some allegations against your credibility here, Ron. What's your reaction to that?
Horrified.
Obviously, you feel there's no truth in them, is that right?
So the question of faith, there's no truth. There isn't any truth in them.
In the days of McCarthy, nothing like this ever happened. This is the worst attack upon our system of justice and fairness. And your investigators, they knew who he was. You had to know who he was. You've lied to the American people, saying he's a very serious leading criminalist. He's a criminal, and you knew it. And you lied to the American people, and you lied to us. You are a disgrace, and it's an embarrassment, and you're a shame to our nation. And they took a recess. They were waiting. They all had questions to ask. They took a recess. They came back. They said, well, under the circumstances, we're going to adjourn. I said, Mr. Ray is entitled to make a statement. Yes, yes, he'll be called back in the very near future.
James Earl Ray's lawyer, Mark Lane, is quoted by the Knoxville News Sentinel as saying, in addition, that the House Assassinations Committee has been taken over by the intelligence community. The committee said yesterday it was not going to call Ray back to testify again. NBC's Bob Kerr reports that a committee counsel got so mad about that, he quit.
Of course, they never invited Ray back again. And there never was a fair hearing. He was dying of a disease. He needed to have a transplant. And they refused to let him go to a hospital. And he died in the prison. I believe he was not involved in the assassination of Dr. King. The decline and fall of the Western Empire began when the Brooklyn Dodgers moved to Los Angeles. Sick ball is played. This is the home plate also. This had many functions. And it's also the goal line when you play football from one to the other.
In February 1973, Native American tribes and the American Indian Movement occupied the town of Wounded Knee U.S. Marshals and FBI, heavily armed, surrounded the compound for 71 days.
Yesterday saw the end of the trial of two American Indian leaders on charges stemming from last year's occupation of Wounded Knee, South Dakota.
Wounded Knee is a village on the Indian Reservation, the Pine Ridge Reservation in South Dakota. It was the scene of the last major massacre of Indians. And since that time, it's a place where Indians gathered and they're not being massacred, they're being oppressed. And a group of leaders of the American Indian Movement decided to move in and take control of it, to seize it. And they did. They put up roadblocks. And they liberated one portion of an Indian reservation. And it was the biggest story for years. It was the front page every day that they're there. It was surrounded by FBI agents and marshals, and President Nixon was sending the troops in there. The fear of the government was that a group of Indians had taken over a territory with weapons. And they had liberated this area, and they were keeping all the federal government officials out. They were saying, it's our land. It doesn't belong to the federal government. You can call it a reservation. It's our land. They were concerned because the BIA had set up a police department which was brutalizing the people there and committing atrocities. And people had been beaten, killed by what they called the goon squad. That is a group of thugs working for the BIA police. I found it interesting because I had been watching the occupation of Wounded Knee on television, watching Walter Cronkite and all these people, and they never said precisely why the Indians had taken it over. They never answered that question. I went there and I found these guys that were all arrested by the federal government, and I got bail set for them. But while I was doing that, there were 40 more people came in. And there were signs there that said, welcome to Wounded Knee, 500 yards ahead or something. And you go up there and then the marshals and the FBI agents arrested you. Nobody said not to go. And they put them all in prison, federal prison. And so I started representing everybody.
Attorneys representing the American Indian Movement tried to go through a roadblock to visit the insurgents in Wounded Knee. The Indians at the roadblock represent the established tribal leadership, and they refused to let them through.
We also have some medical supplies.
No medical supplies.
Well, the order says we can bring in medical supplies.
Several U.S. marshals arrived, and the attorneys asked them to enforce a court order permitting the lawyers to go through.
You got to put the medical supplies in, and the attorneys are allowed to go in.
Could you serve him with an order?
We don't need to do that. I'll take care of it.
I'm not taking it back. I gave it to you to serve under the orders.
Well, you don't tell me what to do.
No, I'm not telling you what to do. You don't have to serve if you don't want to. That's your responsibility.
Well, just shut your mouth and let me take care of it.
No, we're just asking you to serve. This is a matter for the record.
Bill Kunstler was one of the lawyers, and I was one of the lawyers. We had a few lawyers, and two defendants were Russell Means and Dennis Banks. There were going to be more cases to come. This was the first one. This was the big show trial.
But the United States of America is on trial in regards to our treaty rights. The Wounded Knee happened because, and it is continuing to happen because, of the violation of the sacred trust we entered into with the United States of America that involves our treaties. As America should know, the treaties are on par and equal to the Constitution of the United States. So when you violate a treaty, you violate the Constitution.
After all the witnesses of the government, I put on one witness, a Gladys Bissonette, an elderly Indian woman. And she told the story about how one day when she was preparing food for the children, the Phoebes, that was the FBI, the Phoebes fired their poison gas at us. It was tear gas. And it was coming right toward, she told it very dramatically, it was coming right toward us. It was coming, and the wind was bringing it right to where the little children were playing. And this gas was coming from the government. And I was going to run out, but I couldn't get there in time. So I got down on my knees, and I prayed to the Great Spirit. And the wind shifted and took it all back to the FBI's. And our children were spared. Everybody in the courtroom started to applaud. And I looked up and some of the jurors started and then stopped. It was such a moving expression and belief in how good will triumph without even firing a shot. Just
prayers in this case. The way it finally ended was the jury retired. I thought we had the case won. I didn't think they could ever get all 12 people to say guilty. It has to be unanimous. I thought we had a possibility of getting an acquittal of all of them saying not guilty. And they went back to deliberate, and within a few hours, they came out, the bailiff came out and made an announcement to the judge, and the judge called us together and said, one of the jurors, a woman, has had a stroke. And of course, we've released the alternate jurors already. So we can, and they've already talked to the media, we can't have them back. I don't know what to do. I said, we agreed to a jury of 11, Your Honor. And this is the statute that says, if both sides agree, and if you agree, Your Honor, we can do it with a lesser number than 12. And I said, we agree. And the judge said to the government, not only do I agree with Mr. Lane, but I implore you to let this jury go forward after 10 months. And he said, I have to think about it. R.D. Hurd, the prosecuting attorney, said, I have to think about it.
Kevin McKiernan of member station KSJN in St. Paul, Minnesota, has been following the trial for All Things Considered for the past 8 months, and today he has a final report.
It's been a bad year for justice in this country, a bad year for justice. With these words, federal judge Fred Nickel announced his decision to drop all remaining felony charges against Wounded Knee occupation leaders Dennis Banks and Russell Means. The decision was prompted by a judgment for acquittal motion brought by attorneys for the Indian leaders. It followed the government's refusal to agree on an 11-person jury. The defendants treated the dismissal as an acquittal. Dennis Banks was jubilant.
I feel fantastic.
How do you feel?
Fantastic!
Russell Means said the dismissal was a vindication of his treaty rights.
It shows that people can stand up for this. It shows Indian people all over the country that we can stand up for our rights and people will recognize it.
I later met the woman who had a stroke. She was making a speech about these two innocent boys, and one guy there said, I think we ought to not just rush into this and say not guilty, we ought to have a discussion. She said, what's there to discuss? They've been framed. And while she was speaking loudly about how innocent they were, that's when she had her stroke. In any event, that's how that case ended, and it was a monumental victory for the rights of Indian people and a blow to the United States government.
They are so cute.
Oh, no, that belongs to darling.
Come on, darling. Come here, darling. Come on, sweetie. He said, I don't talk like that. It's like, yes, you do. That is exactly, no. And for a long time, you know, he was going, oh, yeah, you think I say darling to my dog, sweetie.
No, sweetie, come over here. Come over here. Sit, sit. Okay, you sit. Okay. I want, first of all, you want to give me five? Yeah. All right. You're a sweet puppy. You want to kiss your daddy? Yes. Okay. Sit down. Sit down. You could go on forever. I don't think it's worth
it.
Is this the Hollywood picture you're talking about?
Yeah, that's it. That's it.
Well, that does prove one thing. That at one point I had darker hair and a corduroy jacket.
In October 1967, seven children were found poisoned and deceased in Arcadia, Florida. Migrant worker James Richardson was convicted of committing these crimes. He spent 21 years in prison until Mark Lane stepped in.
Mr. Chadwick's not here.
My father and I had a talk some years ago. And he said, I'll bet that of everything you did in your professional life, walking out of prison with James Richardson was the best day of your life. And I said, Dad, you really know me very well, because that's exactly true.
I will always remember for as long as I live a case that will haunt me for all of my life. It was the case of James Joseph Richardson, a man prosecuted, convicted, and sentenced to death 21 years ago, or now 22 or 3 years ago, for the poisoning death of his seven children in Arcadia, Florida.
Seven little black children had died. One family had all died, been poisoned to death. And I saw James Richardson. He was a migrant worker, illiterate, very good-looking young man, black,
saying to the news media, because they were all there, it was a huge story. Seven little kids in one family, all poisoned to death. Nobody knew who did it. He said, the sheriff had better find out who killed my children. And he was obviously crying and angry. I thought, boy, this is South Central Florida. This is the 1960s. It's dangerous for a black guy to be talking that way down there. And so I watched the case develop. And then a couple of days later, Sheriff Frank Klein, High Sheriff Frank Klein, who had associations with the Ku Klux Klan, arrested James Richardson and charged him with murdering his seven children. He was prosecuted. It was an all-white jury, as I recall. I wasn't there for the trial. I just read about it and found guilty and sentenced to death. And I said, you know, I gotta look into that. I knew the state of Florida was trying to kill him, and I thought the people of Florida should see the man that they've decided to kill. And that, to me, was an excuse to try to sneak a camera into death row, which is not allowed. I got a little Minox B, I think it was called, a little spy camera. That's the picture. That's an illicit picture. It's illegal because you're not allowed to take the picture, so anyone watching this, don't look too closely.
Actually, that was the first time I had been in prison. I've been a public defender since then, but that was the first time I'd actually been inside a prison. And it's a scary place. And James, I don't know how he had the spirit that he did.
I saw James when I first went in and took this photograph, and then I looked at him, I just couldn't believe he did it. And then we started talking, then I knew he didn't do it. I haven't said that about anybody else. I don't believe any other client, but I knew he didn't do it. And he was crying. And I said, you know, it's not hopeless. He was on death row and sentenced to death. But, you know, the government could intervene. They could find some flaw. Something could happen, possibly. And I said, it's not hopeless. He said, it is hopeless. They all died. He wasn't crying for himself or crying for his execution, which was upcoming. He was crying for the seven children who were gone. He said, how could God have done that to these beautiful, innocent children?
The pain that he had to go through being a lawyer and seeing the injustice, just straight injustice. You know, you learn to accept, to work with a racist, sexist country. But then how do you get ready for a black man whose children was murdered and then blamed on him?
I called Johnny Robinson, told him what I was interested in doing, that I wanted to talk about the case with him and just take a look at it. And I said, what can you tell me? He said, they framed him. He was an innocent man. And I said, then I spent a year crisscrossing the state, talking to every single witness. And then there was Bessie Reese. And Bessie Reese was a woman who lived next door to James, and sometimes she used to do some babysitting for him, but then she decided she hated him. She murdered her first husband with poison. Her second husband died of poison after she had a fight with him, but she was never prosecuted for that. As she said when I talked to her, they could never prove I did it. That was her position. So apparently, she killed two husbands with poison. She had a third husband, and James was driving to Jacksonville to meet some of his relatives there, and Bessie's husband came with him. And when he was there, he met this young lady, and he liked her a lot better than Bessie, and decided to stay there and not go back. Bessie was furious, and she said to James, you got my husband, you made him leave. James said, I didn't do anything, he just wanted a ride, and then he met somebody. I had nothing to do with it. She said, I'm gonna get even with you. So James was always a little bit afraid of her, and James and his wife worked in the fields, and he had to have someone to stay with his seven kids. Some of them went to school, and some were too young to go to school. So he asked Dorothy Bracey to do it. Dorothy Bracey was Bessie Reese's daughter, and she had a relationship with the sheriff. As soon as the Richardsons were picked up to go out in the field to work, Bessie came in to see Dorothy and said, I'm going to stay with these children. So she fed the kids lunch and they all died. Seven children. Some died in school, some died at home. And it was pretty clear who the suspect should have been. But as I said, the sheriff was having a relationship with her daughter. And he wasn't about to charge her. He was married, but he didn't want any of this to come out. He wasn't about to charge Bessie. So he arrested James and said he did it for the insurance. And I wrote this book called Arcadia. It says, Arcadia James Richardson, migrant worker, is now on death row for murdering his seven children. There is compelling evidence that he is innocent. And that's how the book begins.
The book was published, and again, as with so many books that Mark Lane writes, the entire state of Florida banned the book.
They don't call that book Arcadia. It's called The Book. No one mentions the name. Have you seen the book? Yeah. Could I read it? Okay. And then they will quietly give it to him in a paper bag.
We sort of together sat down and talked about it and decided maybe if we had a meeting with the entire town, maybe somebody, it's been so long, maybe somebody would come forward and help us because we couldn't get the last pieces together.
Trish, my wife, and I arranged for a public meeting in Arcadia. And we rented a school. It was a school where the kids had died. And I put ads in the two newspapers. And Trish and I went around and we posted around town.
We put the flyers out, posted them around, asked people to come.
400 or 500 people, the largest integrated meeting in the history of DeSoto County. A group of white guys come in their 20s in the back with big, like 5 or 10 gallon hats. One guy had red boots on there. And I said to myself, if we're going to have any problems, I think those are the guys there. And I had a message. I took a tape recorder into the prison. I had a message from James Richardson, which I tape recorded. And now, for the first time, he spoke to the people of Arcadia.
I'd like to thank each and all the people of Arcadia for helping me and for helping me attain my freedom, helping me to get out of prison. I'm an innocent man. I thank God for y'all being with me and helping me. I love you all from my heart. I'm very grateful, and I hope that God bless you and be with you at all times.
And then when the meeting was over, everybody was leaving, and one guy came up to see me, and he was one of the guys with the big hat and the boots.
Apparently had dated, I guess it was the prosecutor's secretary.
John Treadwell, her boss at the time, said, that cabinet has the files of our case, and it shows how we framed him. And I'm supposed to burn it 5 years after the last appeal, which was years ago. I'm supposed to destroy it. I can't destroy it. He said, that's why I'm an alcoholic. He was drinking bourbon. It was the morning. He said, I can't live with this.
He was in cowboy boots, and he had acquired the file from the prosecutor's office. He came out with the file, the prosecutor's file, and presented it to Mark. And we didn't know what it was. It was a chunk of gold, essentially, and we were amazed.
Activist Dick Gregory and attorney Mark Lane met with James Richardson to reassure him that release from prison was near. 2 decades behind bars for a murder he says he didn't commit is taking its toll.
I feel so bad on the inside to know that I've been treated like this. Surely, I've been treated like an animal.
The state's determined that he didn't get a fair trial. His attorney says he was framed and that evidence proving his innocence was withheld.
The prosecution, instead of making those documents available to the court, to defendant, to the jury, suppressed those documents, and they were suppressed for more than 20 years.
We read the file and we were like, oh, this is it. This is the key to everything.
And so there's the transcript. Sheriff Klein called in 3 guys. They talked with Arnell first and told him that if he said that James admitted this, he could walk out and would not be prosecuted for attempted murder. Did James Richardson tell you he killed his kids? No, Sheriff. He said he didn't do it. 1 second, Arnell. Remember what we talked about? Yes. I'll try this again now. Did James Richardson tell you he murdered his kids? Yes, Sheriff. And that's how it went with all of them. In the meantime, while all of this was going on, David Frost called.
And now we switch to Washington to talk to Mark Lane, who's been fighting this battle as James Richardson's attorney. Mark Lane, some progress.
Oh, more than some, David. First of all, I want to thank you for the program you did a few weeks ago. Letters from all over the United States reached Governor Martinez's office And I think that, together with all of the facts in this case, has pushed this case forward rapidly. I believe, based upon what I know now, that within 2 weeks, James Richardson will be a free man.
We got a prosecuting attorney from Dade County, who I'd never heard of, which was all right, but she depended upon the Florida Department of Law Enforcement, like the local FBI, the same one that these guys who prosecuted James depended on. In other words, it's just part of the same network. I said, I don't know who Janet Reno is, but she's the one that's been appointed, and I'm sure she'll look into it. Well, she had a white guy who's paraplegic and a black guy as her team. And already I was thought, well, this is a little unusual to start out with.
And I'll never forget it. Mark had a very thin file of papers, and he went over, took his watch off, and he put it on the lectern to make sure that he just went an hour, because that was all, each one of them were allowed an hour.
A long and a crooked path, Your Honor, has brought us together in Arcadia more than 21 years after the tragedy which took the lives of seven little children in this city. It's appropriate that this two-decade drama end in Arcadia, where it began, and end as well in a courtroom. It is the role of the law in our society to make the crooked path straight, and it is the responsibility of justice to confront and to end injustice. We are here today seeking justice, not clemency, not mercy. We seek justice.
In essence, I said, the state has done the worst three things a state can do. You framed an innocent man by suborning perjury, by using perjured testimony, and by suppressing exculpatory evidence. That's how you convicted this innocent man. And I ended up by saying, one day, James will walk out of that prison, and we'll all say together, free at last, great God Almighty. He's free at last. And I sat down, everybody applauded. And then the prosecuting attorneys got up and they said, don't do that, I mean, Judge. It'll ruin our reputation, kind of. And then Janet Reno got up, speaking for the state.
I'd like to present to Your Honor what we believe happened and what was done in the course of the investigation and what should have been done for the purpose of showing you what the setting was in which the evidence was withheld and why we think that that is determinative of the ultimate outcome of this case.
I was hoping that she would be neutral. States don't ever say, we did it. I mean, when you hear about somebody, an old case where somebody gets out, it's almost always over the objection of the state. The judge listens to the defense lawyer, he reads the evidence and he says, well, I know, but I know what the state's saying, but I'm gonna release him. That's almost always the way it happens. This is the first time in my experience the person got up representing the state and said, Mr. Lane has said that the state has done the worst things the state can do in denying justice.
We think, Your Honor, that all these points, the six pieces of exculpatory evidence, the failure to correct three false statements at trial, are very material in the context of this whole case to the guilt of James Richardson. We think the result of the proceedings would have been different had this information been furnished. And we think the failure to furnish it undermines the confidence in the outcome of this case. It is for this reason that this assigned state attorney has concluded that James Richardson did not receive a fair trial, that James Richardson did not receive justice at his trial, and that this motion to vacate is well taken. And respectfully, Your Honor, we urge you to grant it.
Then the judge went back to deliberate. I don't know what he was thinking about. I mean, both sides had agreed. Maybe he was waiting for the 5 o'clock news. I don't know what happened. But he came back out and he said to James and all of us that he's deliberated, he's thought this over, and he has dismissed the charges against Mr. Richardson. Mr. Richardson, you're free to go. People were hysterical with joy.
It was remarkable. I mean, as they say, there's not a dry eye in the house. There wasn't a dry eye in the house. It was remarkable. It was an incredible day.
And I got the biggest fee I ever got in my life in that case. It was when it was all over, and James said to me, Mark, instead of Mr. Mark now, he said, Mark, you're my brother. And I have gotten Christmas cards and birthday cards, always on time, and it's always signed from your brother, James. So that was it, because the day we walked out together was the greatest day of my professional life and maybe the greatest day of my life.
And I guess the government can't wait till they die, because then they can come out with the lies and they don't have to worry about nobody. Because, see, Mark take them to court and win. You know, so he take them to court and win. What'd you say about me?
If you continue to ask difficult questions, people get really upset. And I've done that my whole life, and I will continue to do that my whole life. And if that upsets people, I'm upsetting the right people. And that, as far as I'm concerned, is my job. I've earned all of the friends I have in the world. Bertrand Russell, Eleanor Roosevelt, Dick Gregory, just as an example of them. But more than that, I've earned every one of my enemies, every one of them, and I'm proud of that.
Cut, Dick, but done.
Okay, and this one's about three stories high, and turkey buzzards used to roost up there, and Giselle saw them. And Giselle loves all little birds.
But then the guy said to you, you look just like that girl on TV.
He said, the first thing he said was, he didn't scare us.
What is the life of just one? What didn't you see? What am I done? What's in the life of just one? What did it mean? What did it become? What is a life of just one? What is a life of just one? What is a life of just one? Just one.
Just one. I'm not sure you're in it.